Bonjour François, dans quelle région de France sommes-nous ici?
Alors nous sommes dans le Beaufortin, c'est une région de montagne donc dans les Alpes où nous pouvons faire du vol de thermique de relief facilement parce qu'il y a à la fois des prés pour atterrir et puis beaucoup d'ascendances facilement exploitables pour qui sait se débrouiller avec.
Qu'est-ce qui caractérise les planeurs que tu as conçus pour voler dans ce cadre?
Alors les planeurs que j'utilise ici et qui se ressemblent tous à part la taille, c'est il y a deux aspects. Il y a essentiellement la pénétration pour avoir le moins de traînée possible pour mieux exploiter les petits thermiques. Quand il y en a des gros, c'est facile. Quand il y a de la dynamique, c'est aussi très facile. Mais ce que je veux voler, je veux voler par des petits thermiques, c'est-à-dire donc voler le plus souvent possible. Ça, c'est le premier aspect. Et le deuxième aspect, c'est la maniabilité. C'est pas pour être extrêmement agile et faire à peu près n'importe quoi, c'est surtout pour faire des figures très précises. Et c'est à la fois la maniabilité, l'agilité, le positionnement dans l'espace et la précision des commandes pour que ce que l'on ressent aux manches, c'est vraiment le guidage du modèle, la mise en position. Voilà.
Ok, super. Et quels aspects ont demandé beaucoup de mise au point sur ces planeurs?
Alors, mes planeurs, en fait, ont évolué lentement depuis plus de 20 ans. Je préfère travailler toujours sur les mêmes machines, de manière à ne pas être en permanence en train de m'adapter à des nouvelles configurations. Alors, ce qui a demandé le plus de mise au point, c'est d'abord la précision des gouvernes, l'empennage, les ailes, donc l'incidence différentielle, ça je le maîtrisais depuis de nombreuses années puisque ça avait été hérité de l'Axel de Jean-Claude Bosquet. Ensuite, j'ai ajouté des volets de courbure et des ailerons parce que les conditions de vol étaient plus favorables, enfin étaient mieux exploitées comme ça. Et puis après, l'empennage. Et alors, dans l'empennage, ça a été ce que Benoît et Christophe Paysan-Leroux ont introduit sur les planeurs, qui est le mat stab. Le stab a débattement à 180 degrés, donc il a fallu trouver les techniques d'articulation et de commande, donc les cerveaux, pour avoir de la précision en vol normal, pas de flutteur, pas de vibration, malgré que le planeur puisse aller très vite. Alors ça, c'était un aspect, bon, ça a mis quelques années. Je ne suis pas très rapide, mais ça fonctionne bien maintenant. Et puis maintenant, c'est la dérive à grand débattement, aussi à 180 degrés, que tu as introduit, que tu as amené sur lequel j'étais amené à réfléchir avec toi. Et là, je pense que j'ai obtenu un bon résultat. On verra ça sur les images. Puis alors après, les ailerons, les volets de courbure, les ailes sont absolument lisses dessus et dessous, il n'y a rien qui dépasse. Et là aussi, il faut garder de la précision dans toutes les configurations.
Ok, et comment tu vois l'avenir? Quel projet de planeur tu as maintenant?
Alors, ça ne sera pas un planeur radicalement nouveau. L'idée, c'est de rassembler sur le même modèle ce que j'ai réussi à mettre au point sur chacun des modèles séparément. À la fois les grands planeurs comme le SIL de 3 mètres, qui aura des rallonges d'ailes de 25 cm à chaque bout, pour éventuellement pouvoir mieux l'utiliser en plaine. Et ces rallonges d'ailes pourront d'ailleurs se mettre à la fois sur le troll, à la fois sur le quartz, et bien entendu sur le SIL. Puisque les ailes ont une géométrie absolument identique, simplement elles sont plus ou moins longues. Alors ça, c'est le premier élément, de façon à s'adapter aux conditions de vol que je rencontrerai. Là, je vais rassembler donc tous les éléments qui sont maintenant au point, et puis je verrai, à partir des défauts que je vais découvrir, parce que nécessairement, quand on met au point quelque chose, on arrive toujours à une limite, et c'est cette limite qui devient intéressante à exploiter. L'objectif, c'est de faire un planeur que je puisse porter dans mon sac à dos, parce que j'aime bien voler sur des pentes non aménagés, Non, ce n'est pas parce qu'elles ne sont pas beaucoup fréquentées, elles ne le sont pas beaucoup par définition, puisqu'elles ne sont pas aménagées et connues. Mais j'aime bien explorer des nouvelles pentes et des lieux un peu invraisemblables pour piloter.
Hello, Steve.
Hello, Stefan.
Good Where to are you see from?
You. I'm from Santa Barbara, California.
Oh, really?
Yes.
And what do you do here in France?
I'm terrorizing the local people.
Oh.
No, I'm coming on vacation with my family.
Yes.
To fly. We are visiting, we're making a tour de France. We're going, right now we're in the Alps, and next we'll be in Brittany. And this is the third year we've been coming here to fly and to vacation.
Very nice.
Yes.
So Steve, you told me you have a new glider now.
Yes.
Which kind of glider is it?
Well, it's the Quartz by yes. François Caoux. And
nice.
I'm very excited to have it. It's 2.5 meter. It weighs about 2 kilograms 500 or 2 kilos 500. So I don't know what that is in American, but it doesn't matter. it's a glider that for me is very cool because François, as you know, has been doing slope aerobatics since the 1970s.
Yes.
He's one of the longest practitioners of slope aerobatics here in all over the Alps. And so when he designed the Quartz in the 1980s, it was his attempt to make the glider that would let him do his dream of voltige total, this
yes.
flying like with no limitations. And since he designed it in the 1980s, he's continued to work on it in that time. And so the Quartz I have from 2019 reflects over 30 years worth of his experience and his evolution of the design.
Awesome.
And after having flown it for a few days now, I can say it's a big success.
Yes.
It has a reputation. It was very influential in France when its plan was introduced in the magazines. Many of the top pilots in France have flown it, including Eric Poulain, who then went on to make the Excalibur using some inspiration from the Quartz, along
yes.
with his own ideas, and adapted it to the flying in Brittany. So for me, I love to fly here in the Alps. It's very different than what I'm used to, flying at the beach in Santa Barbara.
Sure.
But I like the challenge, and I like trying to adapt my flying to a different setting. The thermic flying is very challenging for me. I have some experience with it, but every day here it's different. Some days
yes.
it's good, some days not so good. And to try to make aerobatics in those conditions in the way that we're used to is very challenging. And the quartz has proven to be excellent at that.
Exactly.
And in addition, when you have good lift, like dynamic lift, as you guys call it here, the flying it does is very precise, it's fast, it's very clean, it's very capable. And I've been tremendously impressed by it. So very happy to add it to my hangar, to the museum of aerobatic gliders that I've slowly collecting over the years. And it will definitely get a lot of airtime, both here in France and when I go home.
So cool. I'm sure you will have good time with it.
Indeed.
Steve, would you say there are many different styles of flying slope aerobatics?
Yeah, I would say that, but I would like to qualify that by saying that there's more to a flying style than simply what the pilot would like to do.
Yes.
Or what the pilot does. Mm-hmm. So much of our glider flying is constrained by the conditions of the slope that we fly at.
Sure.
Meaning the wind, the shape of the slope, and the resulting shape of the lift that we fly in. At mountain sites, many times there's thermals and no wind, or there might be very, very strong wind and no thermals. Whereas at the beach, often we have a consistent breeze that makes it a very consistent lift bend.
Mm-hmm.
So each flying site will have different conditions, and the pilot has to adapt his or her flying to those conditions.
Yes.
Regardless of what he or she would like to do,
mm-hmm.
there's the reality, the objective reality of what is available. In addition to that, each of the gliders has different capabilities. The designers develop those gliders to perform well at each spot, but they're looking at their local spot. So for example, a glider that's designed by someone who flies in the Alps will be very different than someone who flies at the beach in Santa Barbara.
Sure.
Sometimes those gliders can adapt well, like we see with the Dreamflight Ahi. It does a good job of flying mm-hmm. in both places, but it doesn't do better than the specialist gliders in each place. So again, this informs the flying style of the pilot. And lastly, there's the pilot's own skill and creativity. So all of these things come together to make a flying style.
Very interesting.
And there are styles that pertain to each of these spots, that it's the combination of the pilot, the wind conditions of the day and thermic conditions, and the mountain itself or the slope itself. But there's also each pilot within that subset and his or her approach to how they fly. So it's a more complicated thing. You can say, generally speaking, there's like the VTPR flying style, mm-hmm. there's the Alpine flying style, and so forth. And then within VTPR, you have the style of one pilot and then the other pilot, and likewise with the Alpine. But across the board, it's not so simple. It's very nuanced. And so it's something that I think gets lost, especially on the internet when people are talking about what is this and what is that. It's natural people want to categorize things, but it's a very nuanced and complicated question.
Very interesting. And about you personally,
yes.
why do you love slope aerobatics?
Well, I've loved aviation my whole life,
yes.
from the time I was a very little kid and through to today. I also grew up skateboarding and surfing. And for me, slope aerobatics combines my love of the performance style of surfing or skateboarding with
yes.
my love for aviation and my love of just seeing airplanes fly in the sky. This is a love I've always had. So for myself, when I go to the slope and do aerobatics, I have a way to sort of express my feelings, my happiness, my sorrows, whatever. I put that into making these pictures in the sky. And for me, it's very exciting and it's very satisfying to blend this idea of performing in a physical sense with the technology of aviation in this very unique setting, whether it's in the mountains or at the beach. There's nothing else like slope aerobatics in the world of aerobatics. And for me, it's very unique, very special, very challenging, and there's no limit to how far you can take your performance if you continue to practice.
Wow, thank you very much, Steve, for sharing your enthusiasm about that.
Thanks for the initiative, Stefan.
Thank you.